Well, time now for something you rarely see in the mainstream media, a mea culpa. Longtime White House correspondent Carl Cannon of Politics Daily believes the media, ready, gave Sarah Palin a raw deal in the presidential race and gave Joe Biden a pass despite a mountain of gaffes. Cannon saying, quote, in the 2008 election, we took sides straight and simple, particularly with regard to the vice presidential race. I don't know that we played a decisive role in that campaign. And I'm not saying the better side lost. What I am saying is that we simply did not hold Joe Biden to the same standard as Sarah Palin. And for me, the real loser in this sordid tale is my chosen profession. With us now to discuss what this means, Kate Obenshain. She's the vice president of the Young Americans Foundation and former Virginia GOP chair. And Dan Gerstein, he is the columnist for Forbes and former communications director for Senator Joe Lieberman. And Kate, is anybody surprised at this at all? I mean, are you, when you heard this today, were you like, oh, big surprise?
Well, no, I wasn't surprised at what his conclusion was. I was surprised that somebody in the mainstream media would come out and admit this. I think from day one, when Sarah Palin came out and was announced as the vice presidential pick, the media immediately saw the intense and positive response of hardworking average Americans to this woman, this former mayor, this governor of Alaska. They saw that intensity and they immediately went after her. High-profile woman, accomplished, all the things that supposedly the left wants in a woman candidate. She had them. She was basically exposing them. And I think from the beginning, it was their determination to bring her down.
But I want to bring up this Peggy News. Noonan quote. Peggy Noonan is a former Reagan aide, wrote speeches for George H.W. Bush, writer for the Wall Street Journal. Before I get to Dan, she says in television interviews, she's talking about Sarah Palin, she was out of her depth in a shallow pool. She was limited in her ability to explain and defend her positions, and sometimes in knowing them. She couldn't say what she read because she did not read anything. And Dan, what she's saying there is, well, you know what, folks, he's not good enough. And the reason the media pounced is because Sarah Palin was in over her head.
I tend to agree with that assessment. I mean, look, I think what Carl's saying is there's an element of truth to that. I think there was an element of condescension and arrogance towards Sarah Palin, not just in the media, but in the political class, and even on the Republican side. But I think at the end of the day, Americans took their measure of Sarah Palin, and it's exactly that point Peggy made. It's not about intelligence, it's about competence, is that she didn't inspire confidence that she was ready to be president
of the
United States.
But the fairness thing, Kate, I mean, come on, look at this, look at this. See this card, this blue card? I asked one of the people on our staff, give me a list of Joe Biden's gaffes, and they couldn't put it all on one card because they were so lengthy. And you look at the journalism.org survey, and they said that Sarah Palin got triple the coverage Joe Biden got. 39% of it was negative. Joe Biden, gaffe after gaffe after gaffe, and the media simply left him alone.
Look, anyone who watched the vice presidential debate admitted that Sarah Palin wiped the floor with Joe Biden. It was only the mainstream media that gave him the victory, whereas there were at least nine major gaffes on foreign policy issues, something that Biden is supposedly an expert on. But hey, look at the comparison between Sarah Palin, governor of Alaska, and one-term senator Barack Obama, saying that Palin hadn't had the qualifications to serve as vice president. Look at the qualifications of the guy running for president, yet never did the media point that out. Instead, they focused on who was the mother of her own baby, the clothes that she
wore.
When
she announced that her daughter was pregnant, the satellite trucks could not have filled Anchorage, Alaska anymore. I mean, it was unbelievable, the media presence up there, and yet you have on the other side of the nothing.
But Trace, I got to take issue with what Kate said. I mean, the media bias, whatever there was, and I think it was marginal, at the end of the day, the idea that Sarah the idea that Sarah Palin wiped the floor with Joe Biden, that debate is just ludicrous. And the biggest test
it's
of that
not.
Is if you look at the polling after the campaign, one of the biggest decisive factors that people said why they didn't vote for John McCain was because of Sarah Palin. She was the biggest negative draw on that campaign.
She,
and it's indisputable.
And maybe, Kate, you know, the folksy thing, like Dan was saying, maybe the folksy thing's not playing. Maybe the GOP should look for the most brilliant mind instead of the folksy thing. Go ahead.
It's not the folksy thing. It's she has common sense. What she says resonates with Americans who are working hard to put their kids through school and to buy groceries. And right now, they see the federal government stepping on all their rights and expanding and bloating. And Sarah Palin is the one person that's out there talking about it. And frankly, Peggy Noonan, God bless her for all the good she's done, but she really does represent the elite sort of inside the beltway approach. And Sarah Palin doesn't do it that way. She's outside the box. She does things her own way. And that's why people like her.
I got to go. Dan, 10 seconds.
Well, I was just going to say, I think Kate's right. Sarah Palin does resonate with a chunk of the American electorate. Her problem is she couldn't win over the middle in this campaign. And I think her challenge, which was made harder by her announcement, is convincing the middle that she is competent and ready to be president of the United States.
Kate Obenshain, both of you, great debate. It'll go on, I'm sure.
Thank you.
Thank you both.